Now, we are honored to have Ms. Noura Erakat join us today for the third and final lecture in our series, Palestinian Politics, Representation, and Accountability. This lecture will examine the viability of the current Palestinian leadership and the legitimacy of the Palestinian Authority, with special attention to the Fateh-Hamas political schism and the significance surrounding the planned elections. Noura is a human rights attorney and writer. She is currently an adjunct professor of international human rights law in the Middle East at Georgetown University and is the U.S.-based legal advocacy director for the Badel Center for Palestinian Refugee and Residency Rights. Most recently, she served as legal counsel for a congressional subcommittee, which was chaired by Congressman Dennis J. Kucinich. She has helped to initiate and organize several national organizations, including Arab Women Arising for Justice and the U.S.-Palestinian Community Network. She is also a co-editor of Shadalia.com. Noura is currently completing her LLM in National Security at the Georgetown University Law Center. We'll begin with remarks from Noura, followed by a question and answer session for about 15 minutes. For those of you joining us today online at Twitter or our live webcast, you too can participate by tweeting your questions to @PalestineCenter near the end of Noura's speech. Now, without further ado, please let us welcome Ms. Noura Erakat.
Thank you, Marion, for the warm welcome. Thank you to Patrick for coordinating with me. Thank you to the Palestine Center, and especially for empowering these young men and women to take the lead in this lecture series as well as the film series. I hope that this is either the beginning or the continuation of your dedication to examining this issue for a lifetime to come. And hopefully shorter so that we can say it's over. In any case, the focus of my discussion, as Marion mentioned, is about accountability and representation. I felt that focusing specifically on the internecine conflict between Fatah and Hamas would actually be a bit of a distraction from the bigger picture of the Palestinian condition and the demand for representation and accountable leadership. I thought of it as somewhat thinking about the color of George Bush's tie when the Supreme Court declared that he had won the election in Florida over Al Gore. So as not to be lost, as not to lose the forest through the trees, instead I'll begin by discussing more broadly the strategies that the Palestinian leadership in general has pursued. And so that puts me squarely at the beginning of discussing the statehood bin at the United Nations. As many of you know, last September, and this means we're fast approaching the one-year anniversary, the Palestinian leadership, or the Palestinian Authority, which has been collapsed with the Palestinian Liberation Organization, the distinction is immense here. So briefly, the Palestinian Authority is an administrative body that was created vis-a-vis Oslo, or the Oslo Accords, in the early 1990s to serve for a short-term duration to oversee the transition from incremental occupation to a self-governing regime, or government, I should say. The PLO, in contrast, is the representative, the sole and legitimate representative of the Palestinian people, and is comprised of nearly every Palestinian political party, and therefore can speak with greater authority. The PLO has been granted observer status in the United Nations since 1974, and the UN continues to regard it as the sole and legitimate representative. Since the peace process and since the relocation of the Palestinian leadership from the diaspora to the occupied Palestinian territory as a singular unit, here I'm referring to the West Bank, including East Jerusalem, notwithstanding the rampant Judaization and ethnic cleansing in East Jerusalem and other parts of the West Bank, but the West Bank and East Jerusalem, as well as the Gaza Strip, since the relocation of the Palestinian leadership to the territory, there has been a collapse of who represents Palestinians by collapsing the notions of the PLO and the Palestinian Authority. And most indicative of this is the fact that Mahmoud Abbas, or the Palestinian president, is both the president of the Palestinian Authority as well as the chairman of the PLO. And so in this collapse is basically what's been lamented. One could say that the PA can remain, despite its administrative mandate, can remain a governing administrative authority within the occupied territory to administer services like health, water, trash removal, education, to some extent security, some sort of order, while allowing the PLO to remain the representative in terms of in the international arena, to represent Palestinians as concerns the right and the struggle more broadly. There could have been that bifurcation, and yet they've been collapsed, which is central to this discussion. So the fact that the Palestinian leadership in the form of the PA and the PLO, which I say as PA slash PLO, approached the United Nations last year to request that Palestine be admitted as both a member of the United Nations, as well as to be recognized as a state. Recognition can be conferred by a two-thirds vote from the General Assembly, whereas membership is contingent upon UN Security Council recommendation per a 1950 ICJ advisory opinion. And as we know, with the U.S. in the UN Security Council, and its demonstrated support for Israel, this is an impossibility. And so the Palestinian Authority approached the United Nations anyway, and the best thing to come out of it, of course, was this is a controversial topic, President Mahmoud Abbas, who has been governing by presidential decree since his mandate expired in 2009, the highlight of the UN statehood bid was his speech to the UN, which was remarkable and probably marked the apex of his own presidential tenure. It used terms like apartheid. It reasserted the Palestinian narrative. It created and re-energized the alliances amongst the international community to support the Palestinian cause. Although at the time of the statehood bid, I was outwardly skeptical and critical of the bid, as were several other commentators and Palestinian organizations. And the accusation, the fingers that were pointed at myself and people like me who had that opinion, was that we lacked some sort of love for Palestine, that we were detractors, that we were there to sabotage rather than help, that we were supporting a U.S.-Israeli agenda because of their opposition rather than supporting a Palestinian agenda. And yet the point that was missed is that no one opposed the UN bid for statehood because it was a bid for statehood. The opposition to the bid was rooted in the mechanisms to achieve independence. And here there's a difference between self-governance within a state and independence and self-determination. And so to just go belabor this point a little bit, self-determination in international law is defined as a people's right to freely determine without external interference their political status and to pursue their economic, social, and cultural development freely. According to General Assembly Resolution 1541, Principle 6, there's several ways to achieve self-determination that are not limited to the establishment of a state. And this, of course, is exemplified by the example of Namibia, which had been under Afrikaner, South African colonization, and was able to achieve a UN Security Council resolution that called for its independence in 1978. But Namibia did not, in fact, achieve independence and self-determination until 1990. The intervening steps between a declaration of statehood and the enjoyment of independence and self-determination are plenty and critical. And the criticism that critics, including myself, leveraged against the Palestinian Authority was whether or not they were prepared to follow up with those intervening steps. What are those intervening steps? Primarily, they include the removal of this discussion and the resolution to Palestinian occupation and apartheid by removing it from the confines of bilateral negotiations, by becoming representative of the Palestinian population as a whole, not just those in the territory, but those who exist in diaspora, those who are exiled as refugees, including those who live within Israel, who are the indigenous Palestinian population, who also endure forced population transfer and other forms of other measures intended to limit their growth and their enjoyment of human rights. So these were the primary two, and the third, of course, is a resistance to Israeli occupation and apartheid rather than just making it more tolerable. And so these were the basic demands. Did the Palestinian leadership have the wherewithal and the means not just to push for statehood, but then to push for all those intervening steps that would build on this measure, which would increase its leverage, of course, in order to achieve independence and enjoy self-determination? For many of us, we thought not. And in the worst case scenario, the Palestinian leadership would use the statehood bid as a way to increase its negotiating leverage vis-a-vis Israel and the United States. That was where we were last year. What has happened since then? We're almost a year into it. What has the Palestinian Authority / PLO done since the statehood bid in order to build on, and if anybody was wondering what happened with the statehood bid, it was it died quietly within the Security Council because it would have been more embarrassing for the U.S. to veto the measure, especially since it has espoused a dedication to achieving the two-state solution. It would have also been embarrassing to the Palestinian Authority, which has not rejected and disavowed the peace process. And so what have they done in the past year, and are these the intervening steps that are requisite to achieve self-determination? Well, amongst the greatest achievements is that Palestine has been admitted as a member state within the United Nations Economic, Social, Cultural Organization. That, or UNESCO. Palestine's admittance into UNESCO created a flurry. It represented resistance to U.S. opposition, which has pooled its funding of UNESCO. And one can say this is an excellent intervening step. What else? Palestine in UNESCO has used that position to add a very significant Palestinian site, the Church of Nativity, within Bethlehem to UNESCO's list of World Heritage Sites that are in danger. Okay, on the one hand, this is very good news because the Church of Nativity is now recognized as a site in danger and part of the Palestinian site in danger. On the other hand, it's actually not so great. Not so great, mostly because it reaffirms the status quo, but also because it represents a missed opportunity for Palestinians to use their membership in UNESCO to push for sites that are, in fact, under greater danger and greater threat within the West Bank, for example. Rivka, Rivka Barnard writes in Jadalia about this and points out that, for example, had the Palestinians used the opportunity to push for Batir, a small village that is actually sits in Area C, most of which is now under threat because it's about to be consumed by the route of the annexation wall, as well as it's a dedicated site for the Jewish National Fund to build a green park. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Jewish National Fund, it's a parastatal organization. It enjoys tax-exempt status in the U.S., which is arguably a fraudulent status. And it serves, because it touts itself as independent of the state, as a non-governmental organization, it has an explicit mission to exclusively serve the Jewish people and discriminate as a matter of fact. And the JNF plans to build a green park over parts of Batir, and the other parts of Batir will also be consumed by the annexation wall. A better use of Palestine's membership in UNESCO would have been to put Batir on the World Heritage Site list of endangered sites. In contrast, the Church of Nativity is located within Area A, which is under full Palestinian civilian and security control, and is not in imminent danger, and to the contrary, constitutes this archipelago, if you will, of Bantustans within the West Bank that will more or less remain with Palestinians. Okay, fine. What else? What other intervening steps has the Palestinian Authority taken? One of the other intervening steps was to submit for recognition as a state within the International Criminal Court. Jurisdiction would have allowed the Palestinians to bring lawsuits for war crimes against Israel for its onslaught of Gaza in the winter of 2008 into 2009. The ICC, no surprise, rejected the application, did not admit Palestine as a state. There is no jurisdiction. And unfortunately, that's where the Palestinian leadership's efforts for accountability in Gaza stopped. And one has to wonder that if this wasn't just about recognition and membership as a state, but indeed about reorienting the conflict, then pushing for accountability would not have stopped. Other options available to the Palestinian leadership have included continuing to make actionable those recommendations in the Goldstone report. Despite jurist Richard Goldstone's retractions of his comments, which are arguable if they're retractions or not, the report is a Human Rights Council document. It's alive and well and remains valid, and it can be supported. And even this small measure within the United Nations has not been pursued. Let's shift gears a little bit. What have others outside of the Palestinian ruling body done in the intervening time between September 2011 and the present? And this has nothing to do with the Palestinian leadership and even less to do with the statehood bid. Let me just name a few milestones. One is the really unprecedented mass hunger strikes of Palestinian political prisoners to protest their indefinite captivity under a draconian Israeli military law known as administrative detention. Administrative detention is the nice way of saying indefinite detention. It allows the Israeli occupying forces to arrest a Palestinian without charge or trial for up to 6 months and to renew that detention indefinitely every 6 months. And this is part of the matrix of the military law that constitutes the military occupation, which has become so hackneyed as a term that we forget exactly how brutal this structural violence is. The Palestinian hunger strikers, who began with the brave efforts of Khadr Adnan, who was on hunger strike for 66 days before he was released, was followed subsequently by several other hunger strikers, as well as a hunger strike by 2,500 Palestinian political prisoners simultaneously. This had nothing to do with the Palestinian leadership or the statehood bid, and yet it shook the foundations of the Israeli occupation, to redefine those terms. If Akram Rikawi is continuing his hunger strike today, today will mark his 97th day on hunger strike. What are other milestones? In this year, in the 80th session of the Committee for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, or CERD, the Coalition of Palestinian Human Rights Organizations submitted reports alleging that Israel was in violation of several articles of the Convention to Eliminate Racial Discrimination, including Article 3, which prohibits racial segregation and apartheid, and obligates states to undertake to prevent, prohibit, and eradicate all practices of this nature in territories under their jurisdiction. As a result of these efforts, the committee found that Israel was in violation of Article 3, both within the occupied territory, as well as, to some degree, within Israel as well. Major achievement. Other achievements have been achieved beyond the borders of Palestine specifically, and really here highlight the efforts of solidarity activists in their ongoing efforts for the boycott, divestment, and sanction of Israel, which intends to isolate Israel, to highlight that it is a human rights violator, and until and when it complies with international laws, namely to end the occupation, to afford equality for all of its non-Jewish, namely Muslim, Christian, Palestinian, Israeli citizens, as well as to afford for the right of return of all Palestinian refugees. As a result of these efforts in the intervening time span, and I want to name some of these victories because there is cause for optimism in the midst of very harrowing conditions on the ground. Victories include TIAA-CREF, the largest educators' pension fund, has divested $78 million, which is equivalent to all of its stock in Caterpillar, from its social choice fund. And specifically because of Caterpillar bulldozers' tactics and activities in the occupied territory, not least of which was its use in the murder, in the pummeling murder of Rachel Corrie in 2003. Other achievements include the Palestinian Church, There are several Palestinian churches. This is not the one. The Presbyterian Church, USA, which had agreed to boycott all Israeli products and settlement products in protest of the occupation, and failed to achieve divestment by a very, very slight margin that's attributable to many of the mechanisms, and the tide is likely to turn in the next PCUSA General Assembly in Detroit. Another achievement has been Abigail Disney. Abigail Disney is the granddaughter of Roy Disney, who's the brother of Walt Disney, who owns Disney. So this is someone who is obviously very much part of the mainstream. Abigail Disney has renounced all of her family shares in Ahava Dead Sea products. Why? Because Ahava, or Ahava, is manufactured in illegal settlements. And that was the reason that she cited. Other achievements: the University of Johannesburg in South Africa severed its ties as part of the academic boycott, severed its ties with Ben Gurion University, and that effort was supported by 400 South African academics, as well as Archbishop Desmond Tutu. Other achievements: Alice Walker, African-American novelist, poet, children's book writer, who is the author of the seminal novel, The Color Purple, refused to have her book translated into Hebrew, specifically in protest of Israel's apartheid policies. None of these efforts have been connected to the statehood bid or to the Palestinian leadership, and yet represent more monumental strides than the leadership has been able to achieve. Now, unfortunately, the Palestinian Authority has set new precedents that are despicable. And of the most obvious happened on June 30th and July 1st, when the Palestinian Authority invited Shaul Mofaz, the Israeli leader who was responsible, primarily responsible, for the devastating incursion into Jenin and the pummeling of Jenin refugee camp in 2002. And in protest of his invitation, Palestinian youth organized under the banner of Palestinians for Dignity organized a protest in Ramallah. In response, the Palestinian Authority security forces came down on them with devastating force and beat them explicitly, beat journalists, and all as a form of repression. So, and other examples, of course, this is not the first time that the Palestinian Authority has used its security forces in order to attack Palestinians rather than protect Palestinians. Quite ironic if you consider the numerous Security Council resolutions that the U.S. has vetoed, of course, that have called for an observer force within the occupied territory to protect Palestinians from the occupying forces. And yet here what we see is Palestinian security forces, rather than protect the Palestinians, are beating them and in many ways may be reifying the occupation. But these are not new stories. These are not new revelations. These are not new grievances amongst the Palestinian population. In fact, they had been so palpable that in 2006, Palestinians who went to vote voted against Fateh, the dominant body in the Palestinian Authority, and for Hamas, when Hamas won 78% of the legislative seats in the PLC. Why did the Palestinians in 2006 vote for Hamas? I have argued, and I'll state here again, that it wasn't because it was a desire for a new Islamic constitution, nor was it a desire to indicate the religiosity of the region, but it was a referendum against three things. It was a referendum against Fateh's corruption. It was a referendum against the failure of the peace process. It was a referendum against the deteriorating humanitarian conditions taking place throughout the occupied territory. And so briefly on this, just consider in terms of corruption that post-Oslo, the Palestinian Authority became almost entirely dependent on foreign aid from the U.S., as well as the European Union, and that aid was conditioned on an affirmation and a commitment to the terms of Oslo. So it was that it created a situation where the Palestinian Authority could not contest the terms of Oslo or the ongoing occupation in ways that violated Oslo because it would risk losing its external funding, which constituted its foreign aid. We're seeing that again today. As you've seen, Prime Minister Salam Fayyad is appealing to the world because of the financial crisis that's on the horizon for Palestinians because of a refusal to renew aid from Gulf countries, from Arab Gulf countries. Second, what of Oslo was disturbing in 2006? Consider that by that time, the Camp David Accords of the late 90s had failed. The Second Intifada raged between 2000 and 2005, leading to the needless death of thousands of Palestinians, as well as the destruction of no less than 5,000 Palestinian homes. Consider also that Israel had begun building an annexation wall in 2002. The wall, by the way, will be completed in 2020 if it continues at this pace. 62% of it has been completed. And by 2006, Israel had also unilaterally engaged from Gaza and relocated its 8,000 settlers from Gaza to the West Bank. So this is what Oslo had been able to usher in by this time, which is nothing to say of the deteriorating humanitarian conditions. By that time, the financial conditions were so poor that two-thirds of the population was below the poverty line. So the fundamental objections here and to Oslo, just to point out, the fundamental objections to Oslo, which are plenty, have nothing to do with an aversion for the two-state solution or an aversion to the methodology of negotiations. I personally do not think the two-state solution is possible or feasible or at this point desirable. But that's not to say that the Palestinian Authority could not have supported a two-state solution and entered into some sort of negotiations and not accepted the detrimental terms created by Oslo and not continue to acquiesce to them to this day. Minus, of course, this brief episode at the United Nations last September. And just to share with you some of the evidence of the acquiescence to Oslo's terms and to the occupation, that rather than resist occupation and apartheid, the Palestinian Authority during this time had begun to make it a little bit more tolerable. One of the best examples is in the Fabric of Life roads. If you're not familiar with them, let me just share. For decades, Israel has built a series of roads or networks called bypass roads that were for Israeli use only. In the West Bank, that meant for settlers only, for Jewish settlers only. That was to crisscross away from the surrounding Palestinian villages for security purposes, despite the fact that this was an illegal settlement to begin with. And here we can get into the limitations of self-defense in domestic and international law, but I'll spare you. In any case, Israel had begun to build, had been building a network of these bypass roads for Jewish persons only. The roads are built on Palestinian land, as are the settlements, which requires their confiscation. So in what, rather than protest these roads, rather than protest the presence of settlements more vociferously, the Palestinian Authority began to, with U.S. aid and Israeli acquiescence, build something called Fabric of Life roads. In a 2011 Nation article, Nadia Hijab shares that that U.S. aid has implemented 22% of this plan in cooperation with the Palestinian Authority to build Fabric of Life roads that work to create roads for Palestinians that go around or under or away from the bypass roads, the settlements, and the new Israeli wall. So rather than confront this, there's nothing wrong with making Palestinian life more tolerable, but that can't be the end-all, be-all of the leadership's agenda. So again, the fundamental problem with Oslo is a structural one. The structural issues that I and others have taken issue with are threefold. There are no references to international law in the peace process or in the Oslo Accords. This is not to be taken lightly, because absent international law, everything is subject to politics. In politics, the stronger party will always emerge victor. And that's in fact been the case. Because Oslo relegated settlements to the final status agreement, rather than engaging with them and saying that they are a contravention to international law, they violate Article 49 of the Fourth Geneva Convention, which amounts to a violation of Article 47, or a grave breach of Geneva, which is a war crime, as well as Article 8 of the Rome Statute, which is the statute that created the International Criminal Court, also deems it a war crime. Because Palestinian negotiators never set that term, Israel right now is actually not violating the terms of Oslo as it continues to expand its settlements and as it continues to confiscate more Palestinian lands. If international law is not a referent, and instead these politics are the referent, then Israel is in compliance. And in fact, President Obama and successive U.S. administrations have adopted this line and affirmed that new settlements are now facts on the ground, and that Palestinians and Israelis should be prepared to swap lands in order to achieve an agreement. And yet under longstanding international law, not least of which Security Council Resolutions 242 and 338, in addition to the humanitarian law in Geneva, settlements should be dismantled. Second, another structural grievance is the fact that this process remains confined to bilateral negotiations overseen by a very dishonest broker in the U.S. How the Palestinian Authority could accept that the U.S. will usher, and as superpower has the desire to usher in a state for the Palestinians, is a bit mind-boggling, especially if you consider that between 1972 and 2001, the U.S. has exercised its veto no less than 69 times in defense of Israel. Israel is touted as the U.S.'s unique ally. Since the Lyndon B. Johnson administration, the U.S. has committed to helping Israel maintain a qualitative military edge above its neighbors. And so what after this legacy would then convince anyone that the U.S. has a change of heart and because of its benevolence, would like to see the Palestinians achieve a state? And let's say that the U.S. administration really wants to, but for domestic political considerations or otherwise, is unable to. The president has his hand tied by Congress, et cetera, et cetera. Fine. There's something called unable or unwilling. In this case, they're both unable and unwilling. There is a need to search for new options forward that are not confined to bilateral negotiations that involve other countries. And just as on the top of my head, and I'm not a politician, obviously, I speak too frankly, or a diplomat, just off the top of my head, Brazil, which has been admitted as an observer nation to the League of Arab States, and Turkey might be a good alternative to start with. They have together also stepped in to propose alternatives to resolving, for example, the crisis with Iran and their nuclear proliferation capabilities. An example. Okay. Thirdly, and most devastatingly, the structural conditions that Oslo wrought was that they prioritized Israel's security above Palestinian human rights. The equation in Oslo is quite explicit and quite clear that Palestinians will enjoy freedom and self-determination once Palestinians can demonstrate that there is zero threat from the territory to Israel. It's an impossible equation. It's an impossible equation to promise zero threat from an occupied peoples and occupied lands, and in a situation under a regime of apartheid where the wall is being built, where ethnic cleansing is accelerating, where lands are being closed by a military decree and fiat, and to promise that, well, we can deliver security even if you continue with these mounting human rights violations. Rather than contest this equation, instead, the Palestinian Authority has invested 20% of its annual budget just for security forces, which we saw in late June and early July, are used against the Palestinians themselves. And notably, in 2010, the State Department's Bureau of International Narcotics and Law Enforcement Affairs, the Palestine is the recipient of the fifth largest recipient of such aid from the State Department after Afghanistan, Colombia, Mexico, and Pakistan, but just before Iraq. Switching this to one about Palestinians policing themselves as if security was the problem and not ongoing prolonged military occupation and an apartheid regime. Okay, what do Palestinians want? I've said a lot of what's wrong, what we don't want. What do Palestinians want? I can't speak for all Palestinians, but I'd like to summarize it in two points, actually. The first thing, or in a sentence, I'll summarize it. Palestinians want a national movement with a liberation strategy. What does that mean? And here I say it's comprised of two parts, a strategy for resistance and one that includes all Palestinians as a single national body, not truncated between the occupied territories, which is only home to 36% of the globe's Palestinian population. What does resistance look like? That would mean ending all security cooperation from Israel, which, for those of you who are familiar, during the onslaught of Gaza, the Palestinian Authority was helping Israel to maintain order in the West Bank by repressing protests while it completed its onslaught in Gaza. And as recent as a June 30th article in The Economist, an Israeli official has said, "We give them names, they pick them up." Second, remove this issue from the confines of bilateral negotiations negotiated by the U.S. Put this back onto an international stage where others can participate. And thirdly, engage in tactics that are aimed at isolating Israel and exposing its apartheid tactics that include promoting the hunger strikers' cause, that include promoting the movements opposing the route of the apartheid wall in Na'lin and Bil'in, that include promoting and highlighting how Israel is removing Palestinians at an accelerated rate from East Jerusalem in an explicit attempt to reduce the proportion between Jews to Palestinians from 60-40 to 70-30 by 2020. But why hasn't the Palestinian Authority done this, by the way? Why couldn't it have done this? According to the Israeli Foreign Ministry, it said it best when the Human Rights Council agreed to send a fact-finding commission to investigate the impact of settlements. The ministry said, quote, "The Palestinians must understand that they can't have it both ways. They can't enjoy cooperation with Israel and at the same time initiate political clashes in international fora." And that's the problem. Reject this reasoning. Reject this line. This is what Palestinians are asking for. The second thing that they're asking for is for the inclusion of Palestinians as a singular national body that includes those in the occupied territories, as well as the rest of the approximate 63% of the Palestinian population outside of the occupied territory. And I have very little time, so I'll summarize now. So then, why did I not want to begin with the Hamas-Fatah schism? Primarily because even if Hamas and Fatah were to reconcile and to implement the unity agreement, which they agreed to in May in Qatar and before that last year in Cairo, that would still leave unresolved this a representation issue, and not representation in the meaning of democratic representation, one person, one vote, what national interests are being represented. The Fateh-dominated PA has now announced elections for October of this year. Hamas has rejected those elections and suspended its voter registration drive in Gaza, claiming that right now they have an uneven hand in the West Bank because the PA has rounded up most recently 150 Hamas affiliates, and also it accuses the Commission for Election or the Central Elections Commission of being biased towards Fateh because of its location in Ramallah. I'm not, by the way, in any of my discussion excusing Hamas or promoting Hamas or touting it as an alternative to Fateh. Since there, although the denial of its right to be able to govern in the aftermath of its legislative victory in 2006 was wrong and should not have happened, it doesn't forgive what Hamas is doing and has become in Gaza, for example, which many, including Professor Nathan Brown, have described as an authoritarian regime akin to its Arab counterparts. What next? What happens? How do we get out of this? It's up to Palestinians. It's up to Palestinians of how to make the way out of this rut, for lack of a better word. And one of the ways that has been recommended, and one of the ways it's building up for decades but became most prominent in the aftermath of the revelation of the Palestine papers last year and then in subsequent protests, has been to have Palestinians resuscitate the Palestinian National Council. The PNC, for those of you who aren't familiar with it, is the parliament of the global Palestinian population, and it is actually responsible for the PLO. It is responsible for policies in the PLO, as well as electing, or not policies, but at least directing it, and for electing the executive committee of the PLO. And since Oslo, it has been a defunct body, probably met twice in the two intervening decades. And one of the movements towards creating a new PNC has been to begin by registering all Palestinians globally. There is a campaign that is called Register Me, I Am Palestinian, or I Am Palestinian, Register Me. I encourage you all to look that up. It was launched in November 2011. It's built force and momentum to educate folks through May. The registration is now open globally for Palestinians to register. The idea is that once all Palestinians are registered, they can then begin an entirely new process of then negotiating, well, how do we have elections? How many representatives for South America, or for Brazil specifically, or for Germany, or for Europe? And then once we have these elections, then what? Then there's another stage of a lot of work to be done of once we have supposedly a representative body, how then do we impose or exert the will of this representative body, which is more representative of the Palestinian global population, upon the ruling parties in the occupied territory? None of these are easy feats. And all of this is to say that democratic representation isn't the panacea to solving the problem, but it's certainly one of the more constructive steps that I encourage everyone to participate in, and to keep in mind that its success is contingent upon the willingness to take the lead from the bottom up. So with that, I'll close and open up for questions. Thank you.
Hi, it's actually on. Can you tell? My name is Stacy. I'm here. I'm a student at SAIS, and I'm working for the American Jewish Committee. I heard a lot in your speech about this. There were kind of this dichotomy in between the time being of the essence, the Judaization, the movement towards annexing land. Yet you're kind of proposing a very long-term strategy. How do you kind of resolve the fact that this ground-up movement takes a really long time? It doesn't seem logical to kind of reject and look past the Hamas Fatah schism or what's happening on the ground. I mean, the importance of domestic political representation can't be overlooked there, and I don't understand how you can balance out this idea of only proposing a long-term solution from the ground up and this idea of time being of the essence.
That's an excellent question, and I apologize if I inadvertently made this an exclusive way forward. To the contrary, I'm suggesting that it's a necessary condition that's not sufficient. And so there are ongoing efforts on the ground in order to precipitate an end to what is a fast-moving process for the ethnic cleansing of Palestinians. And these are not mutually exclusive tracks. And we should definitely continue on the long-term track as we meet a short-term, as we find short-term solutions. And I'm not dismissing the Hamas-Fatah schism at all either. Failure for the two parties to actually achieve a unity government will provide for further discontent and other players to step into the fora to create a security vacuum that can easily be taken advantage of by Israel and other forces. And so what I'm sharing here is, as far as Palestinians are concerned, in terms of achieving a national movement with a liberation strategy, that is to be achieved by a long-term vision. what's to be done to avert this ongoing process within Palestine. I think that there is a multiplicity of strategies here, and I mentioned some of those in the beginning that are ongoing from the Palestinian prison hunger strikers, from the Palestinian human rights organizations, from civil society itself, as well as from global civil society. It's a really, really difficult question. What I would like to see to avert this is to see peacekeeping troops put on the ground to protect Palestinians and to prevent Israel's encroaching settlement expansion. What I would like to see is accountability for Israel from the U.S. to actually make its aid to Israel contingent on its compliance with human rights law. And the State Department, in its most recent report, now in 2012, doesn't deny that Israel is in violation of these laws. It just doesn't do anything about them. And so these are all necessary and insufficient taken on their own.
Reason, rationale for the killing of Arafat, and who killed him, poisoned him?
You know, I'm actually going to, oh, I think he has a second question.
Is the Popular Front playing any role?
And here, these are excellent questions. Although I'm going to defer on the question of who killed Arafat and why. I think that there's a lot to be said about that, about who killed them, what threat Arafat represented at the moment of his death, the fact that there's now no accountability for the new findings of the excessive amount of polonium, for example, in his bloodstream, raises a lot of questions that I don't want to conjecture the answer for. I think that Arafat has been dead for 8 years. The fact that it took this long to even discuss this is actually part of the problem as well. On the other question, what's the role of the Popular Front? The PFLP, I imagine? As far as I understand, the Popular Front doesn't necessarily have a significant amount of space in the playing field within Palestine or even abroad, mostly because of the diminishment of its own external support, I would say, decisively represented by the fall of the USSR and a counter pole to U.S. presence in the region. In addition to that, as far as I understand, it did support the statehood bid, but it also supports the call for BDS, and many of its members also support this PNC registration drive. The other problem with the PFLP and other Palestinian political parties, especially in the territories, is that in the aftermath of Oslo, many of their political functions, which were aimed at mass mobilization in the Palestinian street, so to speak, were then transferred into NGOs. So that it became the professionalization of these political bodies and political representatives who are now staffers of non-governmental organizations and have just as much a dedication to the organization's success as they do to the broader struggle. And here, this represents the expansive dearth of political parties on the ground able to mobilize Palestinians, and why we should really applaud and give attention to the Palestinian youth movement, which is trying to make something out of nothing at this moment. How about we take all questions since we don't have time? All questions at the same time, and then I'll try to answer them.
Hi, I'm Kevin McGinnis. I'm an intern at the Middle East Research and Information Project and president of Students for Justice in Palestine at Cornell University. And I guess my question is, looking back on the history of the ending of apartheid, a major factor in the end of that rule was sympathetic regimes coming to power in countries surrounding apartheid South Africa and making it militarily impossible or no longer feasible for apartheid to continue. And I guess going off, sort of the relation to PFLP and Black September, but what is the future, or is there a future in Palestinian activism in the rest of the Arab world to liberate other Arab people from regimes?
Okay, I see that question started here. I'll try to answer both strands of that, sure.
Hi, my name is Lawrence Rich. Quick comment about the TIA CREF, which I have. I was glad about that, but I think they might have left it in the general CREF fund. But my question is, you mentioned that you probably thought the one state solution was going to be inevitable. And I would like to know how, I tend to think that way too, but how is Israel ever going to be a democracy when it's it would lose its identity as a Jewish state? And I'd like to know your thoughts on that.
Great question. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for your talk, and thank you to the center here. Now, I have a little short comment before one question. At the international level, you mentioned some support, mainly in potential, in a potential way from Brazil, that has become a member of the Arab League, you said, right?
Observer, yeah.
Observer, right. Observer. I think that it should be known that after the massacres of Gaza, there were huge demonstrations all over Latin America, especially in South America, in the so-called socialistic countries, which have achieved several victories against neoliberalism or globalization. And not only that, not only the peoples in the street, but the governments. For instance, two of the South American governments, Bolivia and Venezuela, immediately expelled the Zionist entity ambassador from their countries. And Bolivia has begun the paperwork necessary to take Israel to the International Court of Justice since the failure that you mentioned. And I think that should be taken into account, because Latin America has been the continent that has supported ever since the beginning the struggle of the Palestinians. And that is increasing now at the official level.
I agree.
But my question is the following. You know that there was, it's related to what the last speaker question. There was an Israeli speaker here about a month ago who is from a very prominent military Zionist family.
Yes, Miko Pelen.
Oh, yes. And he said two things in like 2 hours. One, that the violations of the Palestinians' rights by Israel are huge and unacceptable. And second, that the only solution is the one-state solution. I would like to know not only your opinion that you mentioned already, but what that idea, is it beginning to grow among Palestinians? Thank you.
Great. So let me try to answer these questions. So for those of you who are familiar with the, by the way, love Marip, great SJP. I should be coming to Cornell in the fall. And yes, Latin America. Woo. Okay, so in this question about, for those of you who are familiar, how was apartheid defeated in South Africa? We now look back and we celebrate this as a monumental victory, as the best thing that happened to our, one of the best things that happened to our humanity. The U.S. celebrates this history and includes itself within it. What it doesn't mention is that the U.S. was the last country to support the end of apartheid. In fact, the second highest number of UN vetoes that the US made between 1972 and 2001 was in support of Afrikaner South Africa. So, and that history is erased, but it should be both, you know, it's something that we note and use for optimism, that we shouldn't take the US, you know, the US's staunch policies against Palestinian self-determination as somehow a concrete wall we cannot surmount, because then nothing would have happened in South Africa. I think that there was a collusion of interests at the time that mostly driven by the work of Africans within South Africa, buttressed by the international solidarity community, as well as what the U.S. found in its greatest financial interests, that maybe it was investing in a sinking ship in South Africa, and it could benefit more if it shifted those investments. I don't think any of it was a benevolent consideration. And so what does that mean for Palestinians? I think more of the same. I think continuing at all costs against this movement, don't take it lightly that in 2010, past president of AIPAC, Howard Kaur, cited the BDS movement, for example, as the second most significant threat to Israel after Iran. As far as the other part of the question, what do I think is the Palestinian, some of the Palestinian movement's ability to achieve liberation through the capitals of other Arab countries? One, I think that that's a bit outdated. And as we can see, Arab peoples throughout the Arab world, from Egypt to Qatar, well, not Qatar, but by proxy, to Bahrain, to Syria, to Yemen, to Libya, notwithstanding the problematics of external intervention, these Arab populations have demonstrated that they're perfectly capable of liberating themselves as well. The problem is excessive intervention as opposed to an inability come toe-to-toe with the task. Now, one-state solution. In brief, why do I think the one-state solution is inevitable? One reason, and this is just the factual reason on the ground, the way that Israel has expanded its settler colonial regime has manifested itself today in the presence of 600,000 settlers in the West Bank, amongst a population of 2.5 million Palestinians. The apartheid wall or the annexation wall attempts to circumvent international law and make these settlements as facts on the ground. But still, even in the Jordan Valley, which is on the easternmost front of the West Bank, that has also come under Israeli control. That's 26% of the West Bank. Area C, which is 62% of the West Bank, is also under Israeli control and the site of expanding settlements. The inextricable distribution of the Palestinian population and the Jewish-Israeli population is impossible to deny. Because of that inextricability, there is an option to either create ethnically homogenous states by forcibly removing populations, or worse, which is a horrible idea, as we've seen in the atrocities that have been meted out in the former Yugoslavia, or a land swap violates the basic tenets of the claim of Palestinians to the land, that it's not just about independence, it's also about land. It's about being able to return to home, not just in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, but also to Israel proper. And so these make the one-state solution perhaps most feasible, not to mention the fact that people talk about the two-state solution as being most pragmatic. But I don't see it in any way. I think Israel is more likely to accept Palestinians to annex the occupied territory, perhaps, to then accept Palestinians as their last lowest class citizens, at which point Palestinians will fight a struggle for equality and some form of self-determination and self-rule, than it would be to allow Palestinians to patrol its own borders, its own airspace, its own seaport, to engage in economies with any surrounding countries that it chooses, and to have a military, for example. But I think, I honestly think that the two-state solution is less pragmatic, contrary to what's been driven into our heads by popular opinion. How is this possible? I'm not sure. I'm not sure how it's possible. I think that what we're doing is actually the right thing. I think that by demonstrating that Israel isn't just concerned with its security, but is actually concerned with establishing a Jewish majority in a land that is the home to an indigenous Palestinian population, that necessitates the forcible exclusion of a Palestinian population of 6.6 million, that also is not limited to measures within the West Bank and the Gaza Strip, but is also prevalent within Israel as well. Israel's own treatment of its non-Jewish, Muslim, and Christian Palestinian citizens who are subject to second-class citizenship. They're a fifth column within the population. And in fact, Israel has enacted several measures in order to limit the population of Palestinians within its own borders, including the ban on family reunification, which prohibits Palestinian Israelis from marrying other Palestinians from so-called enemy states and adjusting their status and living in Israel. It includes the fact that Israel is now forcibly displacing 40,000 7,000 Palestinian Bedouins in the Negev desert in order to build Israeli settlements within Israel, as well as to plant another JNF forest and to forcibly displace its own Israeli Bedouin Palestinian population. So these highlighting this and demonstrating that this is not about Israeli security. This is not about Israel's lack and failure to find a partner for peace. But this is in fact about a project to forcibly displace Palestinians and to have control of the land with the least amount of Palestinians and the highest number of Jewish persons, that once we expose that, I think that we can also create a tide, an irreversible tide. Thank you. Way over time.